Okay. Boa tarde a todos e todas que estão aí hoje na audiência. Eu vou aqui rapidamente falar algumas palavras em português, depois nós vamos passar para inglês. Hoje nós vamos ter dois convidados aqui. Em primeiro lugar, a professora Patrícia Pucci, que vai ser apresentada pelo Max Souza, nosso colega, e em segundo, da sequência, o professor Hermenegildo Borges de Oliveira, que será apresentado pelo nosso colega Rui Almeida. Nós estamos hoje aqui na sessão número 28 do nosso seminário. Ao final, eu vou fazer a apresentação, informações sobre o próximo seminário, tá bem? So, it's a pleasure to have here professora Patrícia Pucci, and nice to meet you, Patrícia. It's very nice to have you here. I will ask Professor Mark Souza to introduce you, please.
Thank you, Sandra. Thank you. And also, Jack, thank you for Professor Pucci to come in to have accepted our invitation. It's my great pleasure to have been able to introduce you. So, Professor Patricia Pucci has a long story as a researcher in elliptic partial differential equations. She's a very highly cited author. I mean, he's been highly cited researching in 2018, 19, and 20. And on the board of several important journals. So it's really a great honor and pleasure to have you here. And today, she'll talk to us on about local and non-local PQ problems and hard spaces. And so, Professor Pucci, thank you very much for accepting our invitation. The screen is all yours.
Thank you very much for the nice introduction. And I really thank you very much, all the organizers of this. Oh, I'm not able to, sorry so much. Okay, I did it. Let me first thank all the organizers, Professors Rincon, Suasa, Malta, Cavalcanti, Lopez, Almeida, for the nice and kind invitation, which made me very happy. Today I'm going to speak about some results I obtained jointly with the current PhD student of mine. So I make just a short introduction, even if I know all the people in the audience are very familiar with these PQ problems. But what I would like to emphasize in this talk, the different strategies we have in the local and non-local problems. And so the fact that even if apparently the statement of the theorems and the main arguments are fairly similar, the proof techniques need some care in the non-local case because of several difficulties which arise in the fact that the operator is no more local. Then the other feature of the research is the fact that we are interested in elliptic problems involving elliptic operators which are not homogeneous. Let me say, for simplicity in this talk, I want to just focus on the PQ model, but the proof technique I employ can be extended to more general operators. The literature on PQ problem started in two different countries, by Zhigoff and by Marcellini, at the same year in a completely different, not related at all. So they grew in a completely different situation. Indeed, the operator by Zhigoff involved also a coefficient A of X, which somehow makes interrelation the P growth with the Q growth, while the Marcellini started just with the PQ growth. Then another feature of the research is that usually the problem considered originally by Zipov and Marcellini were set in bounded domains. And we are looking for problems involving entire solution. That means a solution defined in the entire space. So this makes difficulty because in the bounded case, the embeddings are much easier. And we do not want to introduce weights that somehow make the embeddings easier. So this is another feature of the research. And then our problems involve the critical exponent in the sense of the Sobolev embeddings, as well as RD terms. And this combination, the fact that we work in the entire space, the fact that we use a critical exponent, the fact that we handle with hard terms makes a triple loss of compactness. So the situation is fairly difficult. This research was accepted, the paper is already online in the nonlinear analysis in this year, just a few weeks ago. Okay, everything started actually with Ball in 4 years before Zipov and Marcellini. He considered the integral of the calculus of variation in which there is a deformation of an elastic body in which occupies a bounded domain omega along the deformation. So U is a displacement from omega into Rn, and the gradient or the Jacobian, if you like, I denote simply by du, is an n by n matrix. And so the total energy is just the functional I of u with the integrand of the calculus of variation that considered the ball in this deformation. It has two terms, a term depending on the, let me say for simplicity, gradient variable C, and another function H, which depends on the determinant of the Jacobian. Because as I said, we are in the vectorial case. So G has, roughly speaking, a P growth, and H as a one growth, and the fact that to the right hand side there is one is because we are simply in the bounded case. But Ball was interested in solutions with presented cavities. So the cavitation is very important. So that the exponent P was supposed to be certainly greater than one, but less or equal to n, which is the main dimension of the space. Therefore, the determinant of the Jacobian as the growth, which is capital N. So that combining all together, the integrand F has a growth from below, which is P, and the growth from above, which is a capital N. P was, as I said, less or equal than N. So that's why entered the so-called, in this general, in the framework of the calculus of variation, the integrand is in the general form, is omega, Rn, times, and so forth, and as it is a PQ growth, as is expressed in this line, which I point out. So P could be naturally also equal to Q. What is relevant that Q can be less or equal than capital N. this is very important. So I focus, even if naturally all the treatment that can cover the case in which P is equal to Q, I stay in the general case in which P is less than Q in this talk. Okay, as I said, actually Zhikov introduced the so-called double phase operators. So that means I make it here just a prototype, as I said, that this is the integrand of the calculus of variation, which you have the P growth determined by the gradient of U, and the Q growth determined by the gradient of U. And these two terms are balanced by a coefficient A, which depends on the point X of the body omega. So this mixture between the two materials is very, very interesting. And there are several papers developed to this double phase operator, which attract me also very much. I will say why. I make just a very, very simple list, and I do apologize for not citing other people. And I just cited all the historical papers or papers which contains somehow a survey of the main result on PQ problems, as well as paper related to the proof technique and the argument we use. So just a report of few papers, recent few papers, or old historical. So as I said, and I don't know if you see well, or maybe you don't see the first line, which is just the title. Okay, let me state for simplicity at the beginning the scalar case, so that we have this equation, we have this PQ operator, which, as I said, for simplicity in the talk, I stay simply in the canonical case, the PQ Laplacian. The P Laplacian operator is a prototype or so-called A operator in the Schrödinger notation. That means that they are divergent operator which depend on of a function A, that in this case is this the modulus of the gradient to the P minus 2 power times the gradient of phi along any test function. This is the definition, which also has a very delicate feature depending on the fact that the P can be between 1 and 2 or P is greater than 2. And then the exponent P and Q are just between 1, is less than P, less than Q, as Ball said, less or equal than capital F. And capital F contains critical terms. In which sense? Certainly it depends on the exponent Q, because if Q is strictly less than N, the criticality is in the sense of solvent. If Q is equal than N, the criticality is in the sense of Moser-Trudinger. So that in this talk, I say in the case in which Q is strictly less than N, and the natural solution space for the equation is W, which is the intersection of the standard Sobolev space with exponent P and Q in the entire Rn. And we have to focus on this space because we are in the entire Rn. We treat the problem also in the case Q equal N with exponential growth in the sense of Trudinger-Moser, and in these two recent paper over Letizia Temperini, which I said is my current PhD. And now let me go to the system we treat in the paper. And this system was first treated in the paper with Fisciella 3 years ago, but with a different proof technique. And, we in this paper present an alternative proof, which we extend to the fractional case, and I will explain the situation. As I said, I stay in the prototype. So the first, the left-hand side of any equation contains the elliptic part of the equation, which includes the Hardy term. As you see, as in my paper with Fisciella, this is our novelty. Nobody arrived with Hardy, Hardy with an exponent Q, because as I said before, P is strictly less than Q, strictly less than capital N. So Q is the dominant exponent, and so this is a new idea. In the same way, when you treat the so-called double face problems, the fact that there is this coefficient A of X, which mixture the two growth P and Q, makes the embedding very difficult, especially in the Orlich space, so that all the authors stay until the critical exponent, which is P star. In this treatment, for the first time, we were able to cover Q star. So there are these novelties we introduce, Hardy with the Q and the criticality at the Q star. Very, very interesting, this fact. Because of the system, the critical term is when alpha and beta are strictly greater than one, and the sum of them is exactly Q star, as I said, which is critical and is very large. Lambda is strictly positive, and sigma is a real parameter. Naturally, if sigma is positive, things are fairly difficult. If sigma is negative, everything is very simple. So we have, as you can expect, an upper bound for sigma. From what about the nonlinearity H? This is just a system in the sense of the calculus of variation. So H is a Carathéodory function, as what we say is sublinear, in the sense that the growth is bigger than P, which is the lower exponent in the elliptic part, and subcritical, in the sense that the growth, the bigger part of the growth, which is determined by this exponent M, is strictly less than Q star. So again, also for H, we arrive up to Q star, which is the novelty. This growth condition on the gradient of H, gradient in the last two variables U and V, is just the standard growth condition in variational problems. Again, also the condition H2, that means the fact that there exists an exponent theta between P and Q star. Again, P and Q star, which is, as I said, new was, is simply the so-called Ambrosetti-Rabinowitz growth condition, which is standard. And the condition H3 is a natural condition that means that H is non-trivial, so that is easier to find non-trivial solutions. Okay, E chi rule in problems involving hard returns is expressed by the Hardy best constant. And again, the Hardy best constant involves only the dominant exponent Q. And so is defined in the standard way where this space D1Q is the so-called Sobolev Slobodecki space that in Italy we simply call the Bepolevi space, but in the literature is called also with this Russian name. Okay, which is the completion of the test function with respect to the Q norm of the gradient. But naturally, this is a functional space because it is consists also of the function U in LQ star, such that the weak derivatives are the gradient is in LQ. So it's a functional space and not only defined by density. The fact that to consider Hardy terms has a long history and is important in the physical context, as molecular physics, quantum cosmology, linearization, combustion models. And so also the systems we consider are treated in several models in physics. And naturally, this is the stationary part of a parabolic system in combustion. Okay, but from a mathematical point of view is known, but I just repeat for clarity that the fact to consider Hardy potential makes the treatment more difficult, as I said before, because the Bepolevi space is embedded in the Hardy LQ space, but this continuous embedding loses compactness even in any locally in any neighborhood of zero. So this is why the lack of compactness make the treatment very easy. Very difficult, not so easy. And as you see from the system, we do not use potential here. No function V are included to make the embedding easier. So the treatment is delicate. So that, as I said before, it's very simple, the system where sigma is negative. And so we take a sigma strictly less than the best Hardy constant HQ, and in the correspondence of sigma, there exists a threshold lambda star such that this system admits a non-trivial solution UV for all lambda greater equal than lambda star in the vectorial solution space W. And this solution UV approaches in magnitude zero when lambda diverges. So this is the sense of the construction. Well, this is a nice open problem to find for this general H some condition. There are non-known conditions in literature, which guarantee that the two components, U and V, are different. Indeed, could be that if U is equal to V, here H is fairly general, so that you don't know in general, but it could be that if U is equal to V, actually the system reduces to an equation. And so it's not more the vectorial case. I was able with several collaborators of mine to give additional condition on the subcritical nonlinearity in order to guarantee that when we treat systems, the two components U and V are different, so that the system does not reduce into an equation. And this condition we introduced were fairly natural, and but not for this general, not in this general context. So this is an open question to find this condition. As I said, we already with Fisichella treated 3 years ago this case, but here we give another proof. The technique we use, I use with Fisichella, is very general, and we for the first time introduce the elliptic part of the equation in a very very general way. So you see, as I said, the Schrödinger notation, the A operator, which is the elliptic part, which the prototype is represented by the PQ Laplacian, and B is related to the solution, the PQ, that has the first part. This was somehow introduced in this paper 7 years before by Figueiredo, but our treatment was, we made more systematic than in the, but the idea, the main ideas started 7 years before in the paper of Figueiredo. So let me say just a few words of the general operators we can consider with Letizia Temperini, and that I first studied with Alessio Fisichella. So let me introduce, as usually, the potential A and B of the related to the related to the elliptic part. So this is TA and TB. So the scalar is TBTA that comes from the elliptic part. So you consider these as the derivative, and so A and B are the potential of TB or TA and TB respectively. Okay, so the left-hand side of our equation, which comes from without the RD term, is determined when the potential are equal, A and B, and are of this prototype, so that they produce exactly the left-hand side without the RD term I show before. But you can consider, for instance, this, which is the generalized main curvature operator A plus this which produces the Q Laplacian, and B is you see a different, completely different function, which the growth that depend on these terms C that can be also zero. So in the fact that B cannot contain the term Q, well, in my paper with Fisichella was completely new. And in order to handle this case, we had to use a type of interpolation argument fairly involved. So it was really a nice treatment, a new ideas in that paper. And so what this potential produce is this elliptic part, which is the divergence of the main curvature operator, the Q Laplacian, and these terms. But you can consider as a potential the one that is produced by the main curvature operator, the four Laplacian, and as you see, B is completely different. And again, Q is Q star. What you have here is this elliptic operator, the main curvature operator, and the four Laplacian, and this not at all potential. But for A, we can consider very exotic function that we introduced in several papers in the 80s with James Serrin, that are these integrands of the calculus of variation. So this divergence term, the four Laplacian, and this one. So several nice operators. But now we turn back to our system. Our system S, which is involves a standard PQ operator, but with RD terms and so forth. And we spend a few words on the ideas of the proof. So the ideas of the proof is to say below the, as I said before, with sigma below the best RD Q, because things are and as I said, if sigma is negative, everything is fine. Then the functional satisfies the geometry of the mounting pass theorem, so that there exists a sequence of a Pelesmann sequence at the special level that depends on the two parameters sigma and lambda. Lambda is positive and sigma is less than HQ, and this Pelesmann sequence is at this special level C of sigma lambda, which is determined by the usual geometry of the mounting pass theorem. Okay, is not completely trivial, is not completely hard to prove that the Pelesmann sequence is bounded, so that up to a subsequence with a couple UV in the solution space W, which is a width solution of the variational system, and this is fairly natural. Again, because of the lack of compactness and so forth, you expect that the Pelesmann sequence holds below a threshold. And so the crucial step is to prove that the PS condition, the Pelesmann condition, holds at a level C, which is below this threshold, which involves the theta, which is the exponent in the Aprosetti-Rabinowitz condition, Q star, and these two best constant, which are determined by the Q growth, as you see, so, and the Hardy with the Q exponent, and the criticality. And naturally, when sigma is zero, S sigma reduces exactly to the Sobolev exponent in the vectorial case. Okay, this space is the vectorial. So that what is tricky to do, but is the strategy to do, is to prove that these coefficient dj and d infinity are zero for all j, so that actually this critical integral converges to the critical limit of involving the weak limit. These thanks to the almost everywhere convergence and the vectorial version of the Brzezinski's Liebe lemma gives you the fact that the sequence is strong. So what is this is what we did in the fractional case. We stay in the prototype, which is the SP Laplacian, where S can be equal to T, which is the fractional exponent. So S is bigger than zero, less than equal than T, less than one. One is less than P, less than Q. And now TQ is less than capital N, which is N is bigger equal than two. Okay, alpha and beta are bigger than one on the Lebesgue exponent. And now the criticality is in the sense of the fractional Sobolev embedding. And so the exponent, the critical exponent is Q star T, which is given in this expression. Okay, the system is as before. Again, the novelty is to arrive with this Hardy term to arrive at T. And roughly speaking, we have the same assumption, exactly the same with the theta now between P and Q star T, the same condition. And we have formally the same statement, but the proof is much more tricky because of the fractional situation and because the operators are known. And in this way, we extend several recent results for in many directions. I cited only a few of these. So in the fractional situation, there are lot of solution. The concentration principle, CCC principle, was given in the case Q equal two by Palatante, and we use only Q, I mean the dominant component. And then it was extended by Moscioni, Pereira, Squassina, and Young in the fractional case. Recently, the CC principle at infinity was attained in the scalar case by Bonder, Santier, and Silva, and we extended these results in the vectorial case. In the fractional situation, there are several new difficulties. It's not just to formally are the same sequences of measures that now involve the so-called fractional gradient, which is given the Q exponent. Natural of the integral of this term. And the main problem, as you might imagine, is that since the operator is no more local, the operator does not preserve any longer compactness. So that if you have a symphony compactness supported the function phi, the non-local gradient does not need to be compactly supported and can be positive, strictly positive everywhere. And quantity can be strictly positive. So this makes a lot of difficulty. A second difficulty is also to estimate the decay at infinity, which in the local case can be concentrated. And so we have to introduce special weights in order, but weights related to our sequences. And this is the main difficulty. So We try to solve this. So we had to extend to the Victorian case and the fact that we have the Hardy case, the strategy that they were first used in this paper by Bonder, Santier, Silva, and by Ambrosio. But as I said, we have other two difficulty to use. I see that my time is over, so I don't know if I can go in the simplified case. Maybe it's better that I stop here because I see that my time is over. I have other minutes, I don't know.
Could you say 2 minutes more?
2 minutes. Well, in 2 minutes, I say there are, we can, what it's better to avoid is to prove the validity of the Pelezmel sequence. So in these last 2 minutes, I give only the ideas. And so in order to do this, we were not able to do with the present of the X term. So that we have this new proof without the X when there is no Hardy, so that we were able to prove a lemma which already appeared in Figueiredo. We did it for general operators in Fischella, and was a lemma of Lyons. That means that there is a threshold that for all lambda bigger equal this threshold, the Pelezmel sequence that you construct because of the geometry of the mounting pass theorem weakly converges to 0, 0, the couple 0, 0. If this occurs, then you have two alternatives. Either the strongly converges or you have a concentration. So I see that my time is over. So I stop here because I don't want to take too much your time because my time is over. So I stop here because the paper is online and I can discuss with all of you if you like more details.
Thank you, Patricia. Thank you so much for such a nice talk. Quite a nice combination of analytical techniques. So quite enjoying. So does the audience have any questions, any remarks? So anybody has want to do to make a comment and a talk? Or can the audience now open?
Maybe Olimpio rose the hand.
Yes, Olimpio, you can go ahead.
Patricia, thank you for a nice talk. In the case Q equal to N, you mean the exponential case?
Yes. I have this paper with we extend this this is what we extend in this situation. We were able to cover not with the Hardy. We okay. were able to cover with this this was a lower term. And this one, he had an exponential growth. I did with Letizia Temperini in this paper, which already is not appeared because it took so long, because it's a very long, takes so long to to be accepted more than 9 months in this paper. But actually, this paper did not appear yet.
Okay. Another, just for curiosity, you can change the, I mean, you can consider the Hamiltonian system. It is.
Okay, this is very, very interesting. As you see, this is not Hamiltonian.
Yes, this is variational.
Exactly. This is not Hamiltonian. So this is a very nice open problem, Olimpio.
I see. Okay.
Because it has to be treated with another strategy.
Okay. Okay.
This strategy does not...
I think Eduardo, he is studying.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, in the work with you.
Oh, very nice. Very nice.
Okay. Thank you for nice talk.
I look forward to see you both in Perugia in March. Okay. Yes, thank you, Olimpio. Thank you very much.
Okay. Professor Patricia, may I one just a question? Yeah?
Yes,
it's from
please.
Peru. It's from Peru, Milton.
Okay. I will see you.
Okay, and I would like to just ask you, if there exists any work with that model PQ problem with a critical exponent?
Yes.
Okay.
With the critical, what do you mean?
The exponent.
Just the critical without, as far as I know, very interesting. No. I don't know exactly with the PQ. I don't know. No.
Okay, professor. Because
exactly, you mean this equal the Q growth? But this is very interesting. No, I never saw something like this.
Okay. Okay, professor.
Very
see, that's a
problem.
Okay. Yeah, okay. Thank you very much, Professor Mui. Thank you.
Do we have any other questions, comments? Well, if not, let us thank once again our speaker. So thank you, Patricia, for this very, very nice talk.
Oh, thank you very much for the invitation. I like it very much. Very, very much.
And I just hope in the next time that can be presential and come back.
Yes, this would be lovely.
A pleasure. So thank you, and I'll hand it back to Sandra, to Mistress of Ceremony, please.